The song has just said in the last stanza that he beats me to seek his face. So actually the Lord asks us to seek him. Because he knew, kama hata tuliza, we will not seek because we are people. He dealt with the people of Israel, his own chosen race. He knew how rebellious they were. And so he is calling upon us this morning to seek his face. Father Lord, we thank you for this morning. We glorify your name for bringing us together. As A.I.C. Milimani, we are here to seek your face. We are actually seeking after you, O Lord, this morning in prayer. And Lord, we know that you will be found. I pray that as we hear from you, that you will speak to us. Pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be pleasing unto you, O Lord. And that, Father, you will speak to us because we are listening. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Seeking after God is the theme for the topic of our encouragement today. This is just to lead us into prayer, because we are here today to spend time in prayer. Of course, we gave you the theme verse, 2 Chronicles 7:14, which we have already read. And together with that, I will be spending some time examining Psalm 63. Psalm 63, a psalm of a man who sought after God. A psalm of David when he was in the desert of Judah. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you. In a dry and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed I remember you. I think of you through the waters of the night, because you are my help. I sing in the shadow of your wings. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. They who seek my life will be destroyed. They will go down to the depths of the earth. They will be given over to the sword and become food for jackals. But the king will rejoice in God. All who swear by God's name will praise him, while the mouths of liars will be silenced. The most accurate word to describe our society today, as far as I'm concerned, is pressure. Pressure is almost in every area of our life. Everybody is under pressure. Pressure begins at 3 years old, when we are thrust into school. You know, nowadays they begin at 3 years old. And you know, I am a young mother. So I watched my young boy. Because I'm a graduate, kidogo, he's almost finishing preschool. But when he began 3 years old, a very young boy, carrying a heavy bag, because they have 5 activity areas in preschool. I'm a teacher also, so I know a little bit of ECD. So he had to carry those 5 textbooks, and the exercise books, and the lunch box, and milk, and water. Pressure at 3 years old. When he came back in the evening, what did he have to do? Homework. He barely knew how to speak. And here he is, mom, I need to do homework. Pressure. So this pressure begins at 3 years old today in our Kenyan system. And I hope Matiangi will say, was like he has said, that the curriculum will change and now they can be in school for only 2 years preschool, which means they'll be there from 4 years old. At least that will be better. It begins at 3 years old and continues and continues and continues. Primary school, secondary school, until university or college. And when they're in these schools, we are subjected to so much pressure of performance, isn't it? Of acquiring the right grades. Then there's the pressure of getting a good job. and keeping it. They are family precious, the right mate, and building a good marriage in a culture where divorce is easy and accepted. There's so much pressure lately in marriages and in families. Lately, for me, as a pastor, I have been personally overwhelmed. As I listen and deal with people who are struggling with family issues. For the last 3 weeks, recently, I have been speaking and helping a few couples. This morning, actually, I came late because as I had prepared to come, it was 8:08, I remember very well, and just about to call my ride, I got a phone call from a person I don't even know. And usually those ones I pick very fast. Kama ni labda Mrs. Mumu and anipigia kwa nataka kutoka, I can tell her I call her later because I see the number. But for the people I don't know, I picked. And this person told me, my name is so and so. I know you're a pastor at A.I.C in Milimani. I don't even come there. And then I know one of your relatives at home and all that. Then she began to cry. So I was like, oh, so is my relative dead or something? Why is she crying? So I said, so please can you talk? What? And she was just crying. Then she said, I have a problem with my marriage. And then she talked and talked. And I have learned lately, you just keep quiet and listen. Because they just want to speak. Very difficult things. And my husband was there. And then we just listened. And listened and listened as she spoke. So of course you talk to her, you tell her, I'll pray for you. And then you will come and then we can talk in the office. That is just one. A few weeks ago, again, 2 weeks ago, we had another issue of a couple who barely got married. 3 months ago, and they were ready to divorce. And another one stormed my office the other day and said, Pastor, I want to divorce my husband. Blank, blank. Yani hakuna ile, no greeting, no nothing. I want to divorce my husband. And these things break my heart. And then there are family issues. I've also been talking to a lot of young girls. Recently, they come from the UON. One of them told them about us, so they keep bringing each other. And I meet them in different places. And so I was asking myself of the family issues, because they have issues. And of course, their mothers don't even know about these issues. And you cannot sell them at this point. But the fact is, families are under pressure. Is it the husband? Is it the wife? Is it the children? Pressure of raising godly children in our pagan society. World problems, economic problems, personal problems, and the problems of friends and loved ones, all pressure upon us. King David, in Psalm 63, knew what it meant to live under pressure. As the king of Israel, he knew the pressures of leadership. David also knew the pressures of problems. He thought the rich don't cry. They also, kings and queens also cry. And in this chapter, his own son, Absalom, led a rebellion against him. His own uncle, cousin, church member, his own son. And in Psalm 63, David and his loyal followers had to flee for their lives from his own son. During that time, David spent a short while in the northeastern portion of the wilderness of Judah. It is easier, just before he crossed over to the Jordan River. In that barren land, fleeing for his life from his own son, feeling disgraced and rejected with an uncertain future, he penned down Psalm 63. That is the occasion of Psalm 63. David is in the desert. He is not in his throne, served by his servants. He is in the desert, fleeing from his life or for his life. And so that brings me to my topic today, seeking after God. Psalm 63 shows us the priority of David under pressure.
Let me ask you, could you be writing songs if you were under similar circumstances, like David? Could you be writing a song when you're running away from your son, when you're facing death? And if what songs, what kind of song would you be singing of prayer at this moment? Let me hear some introduction. If you were in this situation, like David, first of all, could you be writing songs? What would you be doing? Complaining, crying. And in case we are going to sing a song or a prayer, what prayer would you make to the Lord? Why have you left me? Why have you forsaken me? Where are you, Lord? God, why me? Someone told me the other day, asking why not me? Ninani unataka lose mtoto? Actually, that was when I lost my own child. Like, I was like, God, why me? She asked me, why not you? Yes. Who do you want to be in that sick bed? Next time you ask yourself, why me? Ask yourself and ask God, why not me? Those are the songs you could be singing. Why me? I have served you. Why struggle? But Psalm 63 contains no petition. David expresses longing for God's presence, praise, joy, fellowship with God, confidence in God's salvation. There is not one word of asking for temporal or even spiritual blessings. The guy is worshiping the Lord and he is facing death. Do you know at some point he had to pretend to be a madman in a city because they wanted to kill him, fleeing from his own son? Family is gonna shit. The psalm shows us that David's priority was to seek the Lord. Seeking after God, sisters, and brother should be our most important priority. No matter what pressures come into your life, you will be able to handle them properly if you maintain this one priority above all else. Honestly, seek. Actually, I shared this encouragement to my lady leaders in the retreat, and so they told me, share with the next, because the Lord bless us. Mm-hmm. And I want to answer from Psalm 63 three questions about seeking after God. These are the three questions I will be answering. What does it mean to seek after God? What does it mean to seek after God? And secondly, what does the person look like who seeks after God? Okay, there's another one here which is not captured, so I'll wait for you from my notes. The questions are, what does it mean to seek after God? What does the person look like who seeks after God? And then number three, I'll give it to you. How does a person seek after God? So we begin with the first question. I can do notes for you and then we can pick them maybe later in the day. What is to seek after God? What does it mean? And the first thing, it means to have an intimate personal relationship with God. That is point number one. And this is Psalm 63, 1. David says, oh God, you are my God. Okay. He says, oh God, you are my God. He does not say, oh God, you are the Lord. Or rather, oh God, you are God. He personalizes it. He brings it home to himself. He says, you are my God. David knew God in an intimate personal way. You know, there's a vast difference between knowing about a person and actually knowing that person. Do you get that difference? Knowing about a person and actually knowing that person. Let me ask you a simple question. Do we know President Uhuru or do we know about him? Discuss. Miandika, discuss. Once a teacher, always a teacher. Do we know President Uhuru or do we know about him? Explain and substantiate.
Mbono ju. Yes, my sister. You've never met him in person. Number two?
He's not a personal friend, so we never relate at a personal level.
We don't relate at a personal level. He's not my friend. We don't take coffee or tea with him or lunch. She has no phone number for President Uhuru. Yes, my sister. It's not easy. I can't reach him. But probably there's someone here who knows him. Me, I just know about him. I do not know him. So I think we understand what we are talking about. Okay? I said, have we met, like you said, talked, called, sat with him personally? The answer is no. Now, that is how it shouldn't be with God. If you want to seek him, there must have been a time when you met him personally through Jesus Christ. So we must know Jesus Christ, not only to know about him. And that is the problem we have in churches and in people who proclaim to be Christians, but they do not know Jesus Christ. They have only heard about him. They have gone to church, they have worshipped, they have served in praise and worship, they have preached just like me. I will never forget the day that one pastor, actually he wasn't a pastor, because he had been in Scott Theological College for 4 good years. Then when we were preaching somewhere, because we went to, we called them campaigns, and he was actually the one holding the mic, and preached and preached and preached. So the Lord spoke to him, and he did a repentance prayer for himself. He had never known the Lord. He only preached about a God he had never had a personal relationship with. It broke my heart. And he said, for 4 years I have been in Scott Theological College. I have led people to the Lord, but I did not have a relationship with him. A pastor. You know you can shiver when you hear that. Right now he leads a great ministry somewhere. Many of us know him, I will not say his name. But he knew the Lord when he was holding a mic like this. It is very possible to live in Milimani for 20 years like you have been. And we are proud of it. I have been, Milimani has existed for 20 years. I was here when we began. But you have never had a relationship with the Lord. It is possible. No wonder the spiritual issues that we see in people's lives. Ask yourself, this is very personal. Do you know the Lord? Do you know Jesus Christ? Or do you just hear about him? Have you had a personal encounter with him? When these girls come to my office, I remember one very vividly. She is even a CEO leader in the university. And I talked to her and she said, yes, I have never known the Lord like you have explained. I have never known in Romans 10, 9 to 10, that it says, I have to believe in my heart and confess with my mouth, then I will be saved. And she cried. She accepted the Lord in tears. And I saw the battle. She struggled with the devil to let her go. She came to the Lord in tears. And after that, her face was vibrant. She shone like an angel. She had met with the Lord. And her life is different right now. As I continue walking with her, she had a filthy life, a bad life, let me say. But the Lord is working in her life. It is possible that we just hear about the Lord, we know nothing about him. And then after you know him personally, this is John 17:3, you can read that later, speaks about knowing Jesus Christ personally. And then you must develop your relationship by spending time with your new friend through the weeks and months and years in a variety of situations, which we'll be talking about. Seeking after God means that you're seeking to develop an intimate relationship with God, whom you have met personally through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. What does it mean to seek after God? Number two, it means to desire more of him. Psalm 63:1 again, part B says, I shall Seek you earnestly. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you. Actually, other versions will say early in the morning, which is a translation for earnestly. And I ask you, didn't David have the Lord? Yes. Because he called him my God. But he wanted more. He wanted to go deeper. He was satisfied. In verse 5 he says, but he wasn't satisfied. Satisfied, but not satisfied. He knew that there was more. And his whole being craved it. As a thirsty man in the desert craves for water. The word translated seek earnestly means ardently, diligently. It is to go after God with an intense desire. And this is the desire I see in the holy men and women of God. How much do you desire to know God? And I ask you, how did the holy men and women of the past seek after God? And this morning I was reading 1 Samuel chapter 1. There's a time I read the book of Samuel like a novel, when things were not happening in my life because the baby I was praying for was not coming. And so I identified squarely with this lady called who? Hannah. And look at her prayers here. And today when I read it, I shed tears of joy. It was different for me. 1 Samuel chapter 1, I'm talking about how did the holy men and women of the past seek after God. I know you know the story, but I just want to read a few verses here. Verse 12, she is praying, and then Eli is here. And this is what is, as she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Listen carefully. Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. And he thought she was drunk, and said to her, how long will you keep on getting drunk? Get rid of your wine. But the lady says, no, not so, my Lord. Hannah replied, I am a woman who is deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. This is what I call an intense desire for God. Complacency is a deadly form of all spiritual growth. I think as Christians, we have been so complacent with God. Yani tumezoeana na Mungu sana. We are so complacent. So even when we go to prayer, it is just 1 minute. And what is the prayer? The theme is, God, I want this. God, I want this. You don't worship him. You don't recognize him as God. He is an ATM machine for your needs. God, protect my children. God, provide this. God, do this, do this, do that. Complacency. Are you too complacent with God? Yani umezoeana sana na Mungu. Read about how the holy women and men of God intensely sought after him. To seek after God means that there's always more. Because God is an infinite person. If you figure that you've reached a level of maturity in your Christian life where you can put it in neutral, then you are in trouble. David had walked with God for years, but he does that. What does it mean to seek the Lord? Point number 3. It means to pursue God alone. Alone. Understood. To fill the vacuum in your life. David had fled from the throne. He left his possessions and his wives behind him. You know he had many wives. His own son, whom he loved, was attempting to kill him. However, David wasn't seeking for any of these things to fill the vacuum in his life. He didn't pray to have them back. He didn't say, I want my women, I want the throne, I want all this. But rather, he prayed, I shall seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you. Your love is better than life. What an amazing statement. He didn't say, like we always do, bring them back. I reclaim them, I reclaim my family. Those are wonderful prayers. But this is not the business of David at this time. It's easy to fill your life with things other than God. They may be good things, but they are not God. And God alone can satisfy your soul. Many Christians spend their lives trying to fix things. That is not your business. God appointed to that. That seeking after God means to have an intimate personal relationship with Him, always to desire more of Him, and thirdly, to pursue God alone, to fill the vacuum in your life. Stop trying to fill the void in your life, looking for solutions to solve your life's issues, which everybody has. Seek the Lord. He will do the business for you. He knows how to do it best. And I love her testimony. Somebody said the way God answers prayers. See what we unafikiria? And I have seen it. I am a testimony. I know He will not answer that way. But He always answers in the best way. Even if it might seem not to be the best at that moment. She lost her way. That was an answered prayer. Oh, you asked for it. And the Lord answered that way. But He has a purpose. And you will see it if you're with Him. Come on, Baba to Baba na Mungu. You must be at a particular level with Him too. He will show you. Don't worry about it. And then, I said the first question was, what does it mean to seek after the God we have answered? After God, sorry. The next question is, who is that person that seeks after God? How does that person look like? Okay. How does that person look like? And I say, a person who seeks after God, it's not a religious mystic who is out of touch with reality. Because who was living? We have just said he had wives. He is a normal person. Very soon he is going to take someone's wife and kill the husband. Isn't it? So he's not a mystic. But there's something that he does. Putting God in the center of your life gives you balance and perspective. Balance and what? Perspective. In the crisis of life, never lose focus. Notice briefly, I want to give you four things which characterizes the person who seeks the Lord. And start to look at yourself. Are you that person? Are there ingredients which are missing? And the Lord is able to restore. That person has inner satisfaction. Inner. Psalm 63:5, he says, my soul is satisfied as with marrow and fatness. He is never complacent, but satisfied. You know, you can have everything in this world, but you're not satisfied. That inner satisfaction comes only from the Lord. David's soul was at rest. Even in the middle of a calamity, such as this rebellion, which would push many to fall apart emotionally, isn't it? David had inner peace and calm. Can you imagine that? Very peaceful man. And this verse says, just as you feel physically after eating a delicious meal of ugali and sukuma or rice and stew, whatever you like. So David felt spiritually after feasting on the Lord. He says, my soul is satisfied as with marrow and fatness, as with the most delicious food. What had he eaten? The Lord. He had feasted on the Lord. He was satisfied in God. What does the person look like who sits after God? Point number two. That person has inner joy. Remember I said inner joy. There's a difference between joy and happiness. I can be laughing all over here, but I do not have joy. But I can be very quiet. You think she's very sad, but I have a lot of joy in my heart. Psalm 63 verse 5, 7 and 11. I'll read later. He says, my mouth offers praises with joyful lips. That is verse 5. He says, in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy. 63, 7b. He says again, but the king will rejoice in God. In verse 11. David had a joy not based on circumstances. Okay? His whole world was falling apart, but he had the Lord and his loyal love. And so he could sing and rejoice in God. You cannot explain that apart from God. Those of you who have small children and maybe you have watched with them Lion King 1. And Simba says at one point, I smile in the face of danger. That was David. He could smile in the face of danger. Can you? You must have reached a certain level with the Lord. The third thing of how a person looks like that seeks after God is that person has inner stability and strength in crisis. Inner stability and strength in crisis. Inner. Psalm 63, 7 to 8 says, for you have been my help. You have been. This is, he had experienced him. Ajaza kuonana na Mungu hapa. He knows the Lord. And in the shadow of your wings, I sing for joy. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. God was David's help. David hid under God's wing. As a baby chick hides for protection under the mother hen's wings. You have seen them when you go to the village. God's powerful hand upheld and sustained David. He stayed steady in the storm because he had the inner resource of God's strength. It is very possible, brethren, because of the issues happening in our country, and lately I sense a lot of fear and uncertainty. Of course it is there, and it is very easy for us to begin panicking, but what for? My inner strength and stability comes from the Lord. The Lord is God. He is able. So why should I fear about what will happen in August 8th? And I have the Lord. And I don't give hopeless messages to people. No, I don't. And I won't. Because He is a powerful God that I trust in. He is my inner stability and my strength. But I have experienced Him in my life. I don't speak of a God that I hear about. And this is David. He stayed steady in the storm. Are we going to be steady in our storms? Even in this storm that Kenya is in. Because what did he have? He had the inner resource. Listen to that, of God's strength. Inner resource. God's strength is a resource. It is inner. It is physical. It is not seen. The inner resource. We may have nothing in the outward that people can applaud and look at. But I am very strong inwardly because I have the Lord. And everybody should be like that. Look at your inner resource. What you have. And I go to my last point. No, they still, I said four. So the question again I'm answering in part two. What does the person look like who seeks after God? The last one now, before we go to the last bit. That person has inner perspective and balance. Psalm 63, 9 to 11. He says, but those who seek my life to destroy it, naila naileta huku mwisho kabisa, it will go in the depths of the earth. They will be delivered over to the power of the sword. They will be a prey for jackals, literally, that is literally. But the king will rejoice in God. Everyone who swears by him will glory. That's from another version. For the mouth of those who speak lies will be stopped. David wasn't consumed with thoughts of getting even. You want to say he must get even of them. As he considered his circumstances, he realized that God is just. God would judge fairly. He's the fair judge. The wicked do not prevail in the long run. Thus David could commit the situation to the Lord and act with the right perspective and balance. His business was not to complain about his son and all that. He made his business to rejoice in God and let God deal with his enemies, isn't it? And vindicate him. He knew his calling. He's a king. And we are queens and kings before the Lord. We have a position somewhere. Hey, we are people before the Lord, called by his name. We have a title, we have a name. We are not supposed to go around complaining and doing all manner of things. Hey, queens and stars of the Lord, remember your position. And that God would not fail to accomplish all that concerns him. But he made his business to worship the Lord and let God deal with his other businesses, with his enemies, his needs, and that should be our focus, friends, sisters, brother. Make your business to be in the presence of the Lord. That is what I leave it to the Lord. Worship him. Be intimate with the things we have said. The point is, the person who seeks after God will be a person of strength and stability.
A person with inner resources to meet every crisis in life. Not a person who is trying to fix, ladies, I know it, women, wanyumba. We want to try to fix everything, fix everything, fix everything. Mm-mm. Seek after God.
Amen.
He will fix those things for you. And the last question I ask you. How does a person then seek after God? We ask, what does it mean to seek Him, Savior? We say, what does the person look like? But then what are we supposed to do? And at this point, I'm assuming that you already know God personally through Christ. If we don't, then we'll be doing that prayer. As I already mentioned, you begin a relationship with God when you realize that you have sinned against the Holy God. And when you flee for refuge to the provision God has made for your sin, the cross of Christ. But not this. No one seeks for God unless God first seeks after them. John 6:44, Romans 3:11. If you are born again and you have been proud, I know the Lord. I gave my life to Christ. I am faithful. I am very sorry. We learn about the doctrine of election in my theological schools. It's a difficult one to fathom. That you God saved you, who is saved here, because God elected you from the beginning of the world. Lydia, unajua there is a person you will preach to until the end of the world, and they will never get saved. They have not been elected. But you were elected into salvation. Maybe even getting saved for you was not a big deal, because God chose you first. So He seeks for you. You cannot seek God, because we are sinners. Did you know that we are elected? That when I learned that verse of the Lord, it confused me and scored. I felt like getting saved again. I said, God, you chose me. Me, I was thin, I remember, very skinny, very small girl. Very small. My sisters were born a little Musomali. Very tall and very brown. So I was like, me? Yani, God, you chose me. And I'm going to win here at a walker. Imagine, they are destined since birth. They were elected to death. Typical theology there. And that should humble you, my sister. You are nothing. You are woman. I am woman. I am nothing. God chose me. Who am I? That the King of Kings should choose me and decide somebody else to take. That is why you should be asking God, why, Lord? That is a good word. Yani, why me? Because no one can boast. We have only received God's undeserved gift. But once you received it then, how do you go on seeking after God? And I give you three things here. How do you seek after God? By putting love for God at the center of your relationship with Him. What am I? Love. You put God's love for God. Our love for God. This reminds me of my Greek at AIU. Was very difficult. We can have love for God. Does it mean your love for God? Or the love that God has for you? Here it is love for God, subjective. At the center of your relationship with Him, and I will explain. God's loving kindness, this is verse 3, was better to David than life itself. That is what he says, isn't it? He says your loving kindness is what? And we sing it all the time. Thy loving kindness is better than life. Thy loving kindness was better to David than life itself. Therefore, David says, because of that reason, my soul clings to you, clinging. Your right hand upholds me. What a beautiful balance. David clings to God, but underneath it all, God's powerful hand is under David. He clings to God and God protects him. And I give you a little Hebrew here. The Hebrew word translated clings is the same word used in Genesis 2:24. Here, a man will cleave. He will leave his mother and father and cleave to his wife. It is the same word used here. It is also used in Ruth 1:14. When he says Naomi, sifanye nini, sikuachi, we are told she clung. Your relationship with the Lord is comparable to a marriage relationship. That's why we are conversant with some of us who are married. Those who are not one another, you know. Seeking after God means keeping your passion for God alive. Christianity is not just a matter of the head, here, just hearing about the Lord, but of the heart. As you think of what God has done for you in Christ, it ought to move you emotionally. Not just to do Bible study and nothing. You read the word of God, but it doesn't move you. As you reflect on his great love and faithfulness towards you over the years, in spite of your failures, you ought to feel love for him. Do you love God? Do you love him? Nothing. Not even your marriage and family life should come before your love relationship with God. And recently people used to ask a lot about these songs that the young people are singing. We call it romanticizing God. Wakina Bahati. My heart has fallen in love for you. Which other song has he sung, Bahati? About, he has a lot of songs about loving God. And also Willy Paul. Nimekupata mpenzi. They have, actually. I understood them after I read this very seriously. Because our relationship with God is compared to a marriage relationship. But I hope they love him that way, that passionately. Do you love the Lord? Then that means nothing. Not your family or marriage. It should stand before your love relationship with him. It should be our priority. They should be at the center of our relationship with him. How does a person seek after God? Number two, by spending consistent time alone with him. Consistent time. So Monday, Naomba, and then you are busy the rest of the week. It is gone. David was under intense pressure as he fled from Amphion. And yet he did not neglect earnestly seeking God in this trying situation. There's a determination here. In verse 1b, he says, I shall seek you earnestly. My lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. This is verse 4. And verse 8a, my soul clings to you. David made it a priority to spend time alone with God. We all make time to do what we really want to do, isn't it? It's a matter of the priority. Imagine a young man just goes to the university. He's a student in engineering. You know, this is very taxing. A lot of work, a lot of reading. But then in second year, he spots this beautiful young girl. Is he going to say, I have so much assignments to do? Will he not make time for coffee? To spend with a girlfriend amidst the many projects he has to submit? We always make time for what we really want to do. Mm-hmm. If you love God, you'll make time to spend with him. Mm-hmm. Because you delight to do so. This includes time in his word, in prayer. It includes time in praise and worship. Do you praise and worship? I know we pray and we read. Do you ever praise and worship God in your house? Someone in your life? On a wider church, but we have you on Sunday. You know this power in worship and in praise. If you love him. So if you don't do it, it means what? If, you know this is conditional. If you love him. So if you don't love him, then you have no time to pray, to read his word. You have no time to praise and worship him. How does a person seek after God? Number three, by integrating him into every area of your life. By making him part of everything that you do and say and think also. God isn't just a spoke in the wheel. He is the hub. Unajua bicycle vile inakuanga. So there's a spoke in the hub. God isn't just a slice of life. who rounds out your other passions. God should permeate every area of your life. He is at the center of every decision you make. He is the Lord of every relationship you have. You cannot manage your money, business, work, your family, your education, where God is not an integral part, if you love. So there's no division between sacred and secular. All of it is related to God. And so Pastor Rachel can go and work in Kenya Commercial Bank. Am I serving God? Yes. Because there's no difference between sacred and God. Secular. I can work anywhere. I will be serving God. Because they are God's people. But we try to differentiate. What you do on Sunday is very sacred. But the whole of the week, we don't know what happened. There is no division between sacred and secular. All of life is related to God. In his situation, it would be understandable, isn't it, for David, if God were temporarily squeezed out of the picture to sort this situation first. That is what we do. But David is following hard after God. This is what God in James Version says. He follows hard after God. God was at the center of David's present and his future. No area was off limits to God. And you made God an integral part of everything in your life. Or is there some time that you tell him, Kakwabut kidogo, I sought myself first. And I give you the points to ponder here. How is it with you and God? Perhaps you say, I'm actively involved in serving him. That's fine. But that's what I am asking today. You can be in full-time ministry and lose sight of seeking God himself. And I was reading a story about a pastor who was very powerful. He had done many ministries, he had preached all over. And then one time, he fell ill. He felt very sick. And then when he was on his hospital bed, he prayed and said, oh God, how can you let this happen? I was supposed to preach in this crusade. I was supposed to hold this conference. And he had God ask him silently, have you gotten your work ahead of your worship? Have you gotten your work ahead of your worship? Because we can easily serve God as a duty. But we have nothing. We don't worship him. Our heads are there, but our hearts are not there. You need to retreat and ask yourself, have I gotten my work ahead of my worship? This is God's work. Review your past week or month and ask yourself, did my schedule reflect that seeking God was my number one priority in your schedules? Did you have any time for God? Was it the center of everything that you did? You say, well, that's my priority, but I've been under a lot of pressure. Pressure, listen, is what reveals your true priorities. Actually, pressure is the test. When the pressure is on, everything but essential gets set aside, isn't it? Yes. When there is pressure, you set everything aside to handle your number one priority. So pressure is the test. The Holy Spirit is telling us through David, seeking God is essential. If it is not essential for you, then you've got to join David, the man after God's heart, in making it so. And now I regard to 2 Chronicles 7 and ask ourselves today, how is the situation in Kenya right now, or in our lives, or in our families, in the church? Is the prophecy in 2 Chronicles 7:13? This is the answer. What is happening right now in our lives? Is the prophecy in 2 Chronicles 7:13. I will read for you what it says. The Lord says, and this is the story of King Solomon. They had completed the temple, the beautiful one, and he had just dedicated it to the Lord. And they had praised and worshipped, and the presence of the Lord had come. And then God talks to him. And he says, when I shut up the heavens, this is 7:13. Before 14, so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague to my people. And I say, this is the prophecy revealed today. And I ask you, have the heavens been shut? Have they? Where is the rain? You saw the documentary yesterday of my land, Makweni. And I say, the wangenda kitui, wangenda kodi, kitise, that is productive. I wish they went to where I was born, Ikula right now. I can imagine, if the situation in Makweni is like that, Ikula never rains at all. So the situation is the worst. The heavens have been shut. So, you know your God is saying, when I shut. When means it will happen. It doesn't say if I shut. Okay. Semantics there, we call them. Semantics. When I shut, it will happen. I will shut them. He has shut them, isn't it? He says again, and I ask you, are we staring at an imminent plague or plagues? Because he says, there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, and they have come in no manner, or send a plague to my people. And I wonder why this word has come at this time. Are we staring at an imminent plague or plagues? This is the situation in Kenya right now. These are the situation in our families. They are real. People are dying. There is no longer a story. Kwa sababu ya njaa. They are dying. Is there a remedy? Is there a remedy? When he shuts up the heavens, and he has done it, and when he lets locusts to devour the land and sends plagues upon us, is there a remedy? Yes. So that is why we don't despair. The situation is there. Get this point very clearly, because I've seen a lot of despair. The situation is like that. It is bad, isn't it? It is real. It is happening. But should we just stop there? I ask, what is the Christian's response? A.I.C. Milimani, Milimani as a church. What is our response? 2 Chronicles 7:14. I read for you. It says, if my people, semantics again, if, this is not when, which means they may not, it is their choice. Sawa sawa. Now to know it is their choice. We have 250 women, isn't it? Today I was expecting at least 100 or 150. If my people, it is their choice. So this is in your hands, sisters. This is not when. It will not happen. The calamities will come, that it will happen. It has already happened. But now the response is if. It is your choice. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, will. Semantics there again. Choice. So they can choose either to humble and pray or not. Will humble, three things here. They will humble themselves and pray. Actually, they are four. And seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. But the parenthesis is if and will. Are we the people of God, the church? Yes. I just taught ecclesiology to the youth the other day, and they are here. So they know that we are a people of God. Because church is the building, yes. Church is the universal church, all Christians. But church is the small congregation here today. We are a church. And church is also everybody who is born again. Whatever we are in the world, we are the body of Christ. So we are the people of God, yes. So we are the people. Must humble ourselves. We must. This is the proper attitude and motive to prayer. We do not come to prayer like you remember that man in the New Testament. The Pharisee. You say that I give my tithe, I do this. The right attitude to prayer. Prayer is an attitude. Prayer is a motive. And he says, seek God's faith. Faith has already discussed. But we must also turn away from our sins. Sasa, ako sijui kama nitaendelea. Because we cannot pray until we are qualified. If, my people. Are we God's people? Hiyo tumekubaliana. Are we going to humble before the Lord?
Yes.
Do we come to the Lord today in humility? Don't be so easy to answer. Because it is not because of now that you are seated here. It is your life. Has the Lord been the center of your life? Are you humble or haughty? I pray. Have you been seeking God's way? But the last one, turn from their wicked ways. Are we willing to turn from our wicked ways today? Yes, I hope so. Then there comes the solution. So there is hope. But there's something that the situation is there. But we have a responsibility. And there, here comes the situation. The response. The solution. God's response is in part B. So what's up? Of 7:14, he says, then will I hear from heaven. Then, after what? After we have humbled, after we have sought his face, after we have prayed. Because there's a difference between praying and wishing. I have realized that many times we just wish, we don't pray. You say, na hii kitu inasumbua sana. Pray about, don't just think about prayer. You must pray. And turn away from our wicked ways. Then the Lord promises, I will hear from heaven. And I will forgive their sins and will heal their land. See, whose sins have been forgiven here? Their sins, whose sins? Are they the sins for the nation, the leader? Whose sins? The people of God's sins. Because I think there is a conclusion. How can God forgive sins of people who do not know? They have no relationship. This is why we are called to start in the gap. And I want to be very sure. 2 Chronicles 7:14, part B. Musiseme, I read from my laptop. I did read from the Bible. Because it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves from their wicked ways, then I will heal from heaven, hear from heaven, and will forgive their sins, and will heal their land. Whose sins are being forgiven? The people of God sin. The church is sick. Not the world. The world has its own issues. But we are not concerned about the world. He says he will heal, forgive their sins, our sins. Unaona bali shida iko. The church has not confessed. The people of God have not sought his face. They have not turned away from their wicked ways. So the land is sick because we are the people of God. We are the chosen. We are the light of the world. The Lord blesses the world through the church. So if the church is tainted, if the church is filthy, if the church is sinful, then the land is sick. No wonder. Usiulize shida iko wapi. Usiulize where the corruption has come from, so many other things. Right in the church. Kwa pamoja.
Yes.
Yes. The church is sick. Because the Lord is not going to heal and forgive the world. Our due Mungu how it is us. Did you know that? He is not forgiving the sins of the world. The sins of the church. So that our land can be healed. So sisi tumefungia baraka za Kenya. Sisi wa Kristo. Na sio sisi Milimani A.I.C. See, it is the church in Kenya. Because now we are talking about Kenya. But we can do something, we say. We will do our part. We are going to repent and turn from our wicked ways. The Lord will heal their land. He promises, God will hear from heaven. He hears, doesn't he? After the ifs, he will hear from heaven. He assures us, he will forgive our sins. And he will heal our land. I have seen people struggle with forgiving themselves, even after the Lord has forgiven them. I have been with them here and outside as well. Told me, Pastor, I was so bad. I feel so bad. I tell them, that is the voice of the devil. He has already forgiven you. So you're free. I see tunajifunga sana. There's a pastor who told me, when the devil reminds you of your past, remind him of his future. Then that is what the devil does. of yesterday and you dwell there. Paul says in Philippians 3:14, forgetting what is gone and pressing on, he will forgive our sins. We will no longer live like yesterday. He will forgive them and he will heal our land. He has assured us. So do we need to despair? Do we need to be afraid? Do we need to look for any other remedies? Seek his face. Yeah. Seek after his face. Church. Conclusion, I ask you. Are you called of the Lord? Are you going to humble yourself and pray? Are you willing to seek God's face? Are you going to turn from your wicked ways? Those are the prerequisites to the Lord here in our prayers. Mm-hmm. And so we will take time to do that. Because the Lord blesses you so much. I wish the keyboard person was here. We will spend some time in the Lord, in the presence of the Lord. We want to seek after his face. We want to confess our sins before him, the Lord, who never sins. Because we are unworthy, even as we come before him. So I want us to take some time for simply confession. And this is how you confess. Like David, first of all, you worship the Lord. That is how you open the gates, the heart here of God. Before we put in our things here, we penetrate the throne through worship. We worship him. We invite him. And then we confess our sins before him. Just confess your sins. Don't confess the sins of your neighbor. You know that is how sometimes we tonadifanya we are very holy. Of your family, begin with you and me. I will confess mine to the Lord who knows them and knows our hearts. So he's going to give us some worship song, just one song.